again, guys and gals, and welcome to another video from the team here at BlenderTech.com. If you enjoyed or learned something from the video, consider liking it and consider subscribing for more Blender, Unity 3D coding, and all sorts of other CG related videos. Lastly, don't forget our motto, create your way. So the official release of Blender 2.73 was released by the team here in the last few hours. It is now available to all users from the direct download page, so go ahead and install it as I've done. I'm going to quickly go over some of the features that you will see in Blender 2.73. So some of the first things we see are we have this grease pencil tab under your main toolbar here, and it looks fairly similar as before, but now when you draw with it, I'm going to turn on continuous draw so that I don't have to hit draw every time I want to draw a line. I can draw just whatever, and now we can hit enable editing, and we can do what we would normally do with 3D objects with our grease pencil stroke. So we can select with circle select or box select or by just right clicking, and it now works on a point system. So you see, let me turn on screencast keys. You can see we can press G to grab points, so you can edit your grease pencil lines. So obviously you can make animations in this way. I'm not going to get into too much depth about that. You can also rotate grease pencil points. You can scale them. All the things here and a few more. So yeah, that's one of the major things that they've worked on in the new version of, or in version 2.73, I should say, is the grease pencil system. And you also have you can add a bunch of grease pencil layers right here, which can be attached to the scene or to an object. And under the dope sheet, under grease pencil, we have our layers here. And if I get in a little closer here, you can see my keyframes for frames 1 and 2. So under the graph editor, we can now we can circle select points to create our own perfectly customized curves in whatever way we want, which will make things much easier. They work just as regular curve handles do in Blender, so you can rotate and scale them and such just as you regularly would with any other curve handles in Blender. And I was having some stability issues with the release candidate when it came to doing tracking in the movie clip editor, but it now seems to be extremely stable. I haven't had any crashes yet testing some tracking in it, and the tracking seems to be a little bit more accurate, but of course that is always open to interpretation. Since I've been taking a sculpting class, sculpting has gotten some neat little add-ons. I will just get rid of all this grease pencil junk. So we take our cube here, and I'll go into sculpt mode. And we now have the ability to, we have our tools here. If we press F to change the tool size, the radius, whatever you want to call it, you can now just enter in a number. So I can enter in 90 and get 90 pixels, or I could enter in 30 and get 30 pixels, or I can press equals 90 divided by 3 to get 30. So it now, in addition to allowing you to do numerical input, it also allows you to do advanced input, which is something I cover in my tips and tricks series, where when you go to enter in a value, say you're scaling, rotating, whatever, in this case I'm changing the brush size, if you press equals, you can do math. So I can go pi times 3 and I get 9.42 as my brush radius. So that's kind of cool that it's implemented the exact same way as it would for any other numerical input, and the same works for the strength. So if I press Shift F for the strength, again, I can enter in anywhere from 0 to 1, obviously. So if I enter in 0 to some 5, I get 50% brush strength. So very, very useful. In addition, they have added to the snake hook brush, they have added a strength manipulation input, so we can have strength from 0 to 1, whereas before you just had full strength. Let me turn on Dyntopo so that I actually can get something. So now I can completely grab continuously with 100% strength like we had before, but now we can also turn the strength down and just get little grabs. And the same with the actual grab tool. Before, it did not have a strength. Now I can grab with complete full strength, or Again, also I can grab with just lower strength. I want to quickly mention knife cuts. I'll just load a new file up. So with my subdivided cube here, if I bring up the knife tool and click, I can now make freehand cuts, whereas before we were basically stuck to basically polygonal cuts only. So very, very, very cool. And if I complete my cut and press Z to enable cut through and hit enter, it should make a nice cut all the way through. Okay, in this case it didn't, but you get the idea. We can now make complete freehand cuts. Very, very useful for doing organic cuts with the knife tool, which will come in very handy in a lot of cases. And some modeling add-ons. So as you can see, I've taken a few faces and made them black with my material here, whereas the remaining faces, the inverse faces, are with the other material. And before I go on, I want to add that they've added viewport specularity, so we now have complete specularity in the viewport. Very, very cool. It'll make things look a lot better in the viewport as we move towards their new what Ton's outlined in the new viewport ideas. But anyways, in addition to that, we now have select similar as a new selection tool. So if I select a black face, I can go to select similar. Now the hotkey for this is new, it's shift G, and I can select material and it will select just the black faces. Now obviously I could have done this by just hitting the select button with this material selected, but there's all sorts of other options. You can go by image, area, polygonal sides, perimeter, normal, coplanar, etc, etc, etc. And I explained this in my last video by making faces of different area and then showing how it would only select faces that have the exact same area. So very, very cool, and definitely will become useful in a lot of situations. Cycles render engine has gotten some speed ups, as well as allowing us to render inside of voluminous objects and such, which is very neat, and I'm sure will allow for some very, very cool renders to be shown. I'm not going to go into full detail about that. That would take too much time in this brief overview. Something I found by accident in the RC that is very, very neat is if we add a world background. So let's say I have an environment texture and I open one. I won't use an actual HDR or something. I'll just quickly grab, say, the Blender logo here. And so we would now have, if we went to rendered mode in older versions of Blender, yes, that would be the world background. But now if we're just in regular, any other mode, say solid mode in this case, under the end panel, under display, we can hit world background and we now see it in addition to our grid floor and any other things we've enabled. So very, very, very useful in addition to the performance boost, because we don't have to actually render it out. So that is very useful for sure when it comes to I'm using environment, well, basically any background image. So that is something that I've been actually really, really enjoying. We now have a new full screen mode to do work in. So before you would go shift space to get this kind of full screen, or control up and down, same deal. But now if we go Alt F10, we get this extreme full screen mode with nothing to get in the way. And then if you go up to the top right corner with your mouse and hover, you get the return button. So that's how the new full screen UI works. So that'll definitely be great, because screen real estate can definitely become an issue when you're working with complex scenes, and maybe if you have windows broken and certain things open in different windows. And while we're in full screen mode, you can also hit Alt F9 to bring up the regular header panel. So as you would see down here, if you need to change something, say I wanted to go into edit mode and I didn't know the hotkey to go between vertex, edge, and face selection, I can just instead press Alt F9 and I get that panel back. Or if I want to change the vertex snap and I don't know the hotkey for that, for example, again, I just have to hit Alt F9 and then again it goes away. Same deal in Alt F10 to get out and in of it. Or again, we have the button up there. So yes, that will be great for getting extra screen real estate. Another great one that I've been wishing for ages and they finally implemented is the ability to rename render slots. So if you have a scene that you're ready to render, you obviously render it out and it brings it up like this if you have stock settings. However, we can now rename our render slots. So you may have needed this before where you are, say you have a say you're adding different textures, a displacement texture, a specular texture, a bump map texture, and say whatever you might come across, and you really don't know where they are. It's just slot numbers. Now, say I'm in slot one, I've got this rendered. All I do is open up the end panel, the properties panel, and we have slot names. So I can now name this. Let's just say I would say test render one. And you'll see now we have test render one as slot one. And then let's say I go to slot eight and I change this. Let's say I grab the cube, rotate it, and then render it again. Now slot eight, okay, that doesn't really mean anything. But again, we can now say, I'll just say this is a rotated render test. So just like that, we can now rename render slots. So that is going to come in very, very useful. I would love to have an addition so that we could have as many render slots as we want. But hey, I'm not complaining. This is definitely going to increase workflow. Just while we're here, another cool one is that we have a rendered image now. You can now you always had these controls before, but you can do a render border from within the actual rendered whatever window you're rendering to. So if I hit Control Alt B to set a render, or sorry, Control B, and then select an area. You'll see border over in the properties panel is now checked off. If I hit F12 to render again, you'll see it's only rendered that. So basically, it's a render border. Basically, it would work in the 3D viewport, but I don't have to go all the way back to the 3D viewport to choose a different spot to render. So the only real use I see for this is if you render out an image and you just want to save a small part of it, but it's a new feature nonetheless. I also forgot that if we take our subdivided cube here and bring up K for our knife tool, I don't know why screencast keys turned off. If we take our subdivided cube here, I forgot, and bring up the knife tool too, we can do our freehand cut, yes, but we can also at any point double click and you'll see it automatically closes the cut. It'll automatically go to the next nearest end. Well, it'll go to the start point as the fly crows. Basically, I guess is the easiest way to describe it. So hit enter, and it's cut through as you can see, and it's completed the loop. Basically, not the best example. Obviously, it didn't work 100% there. But yeah, you can cut off. You can finish loops by double clicking instead of having to manually finish them. So that is going to be a time saver. Now, if you've used the sequencer before, which I don't do a lot of, you basically have this view by stock, but now we have this use backdrop button available in the header bar for us, and so we can check that off. And now, just like in the node editor, you have a backdrop just like in the node editor when you're doing compositing and such, and you're compositing stuff together, and you have the backdrop. However, it doesn't allow you to, as far as I know, it doesn't allow you to do like the fit and such. If I was to go to the node editor under compositing, click use nodes and backdrop and bring in my movie, just connect it to a viewer and we have it backdropped, but we can fit it to the size of our window. So if we resize our window, we can hit fit and we still see our entire movie sequence, whereas in the our entire movie clip, whereas in the video sequence editor, you have to drag the window and it automatically fits. So that's different and kind of cool, but you don't have those options necessarily. So it can be positive or negative depending how you look at it. But yeah, being able to see where you are in your movie clip in the video sequence editor, very cool if you're using Blender for video editing or stuff like that. Also, when you take a strip and you grab it, you can now as long as you're holding down control, you can now snap it. You can see down at the bottom, it's trying to move, but it's snapping to the beginning point of the other strip. And if I went all the way to the end, you can see I can grab it and snap it right to the end. Or I can grab it from over here and snap it right to the end like that. So yeah, a couple little add-ons they've added there. And I also want to note the movie clip editor, when you're doing tracking, the motion tracking stock layout has been changed a little bit. So we now have the dope sheet, the graph editor, and the 3D viewport available, as well as, of course, your standard movie clip editor area. And just to add on to that, they've now added predictive tracking. It's fully supported now in Blender. So basically, you don't have to do anything. It just basically what Blender will do is it'll take a point and then it'll try to predict where that point is going to be in the next frame based on previous data. And if it finds it, then perfect, it works. And if not, it goes back to the brute, whatever it calls it. I can't even remember. That definitely makes tracking a lot faster and easier. So that is very cool. I'm doing a lot of tracking lately, so that'll be interesting to play around with and see how accurate it is. So anyways, I think I've gone over all of the major new features in 2.73. There's a lot more. There's hundreds of bug fixes, but hopefully you guys enjoy some of the new add-ons and fixes, and of course we are excited for 2.74 now. But anyways, thanks for watching from the team here at BlenderTech.com. If you enjoyed this video and learned or enjoyed something, please consider liking it, and don't forget to subscribe for more videos. We're on Twitter at twitter.com/blender_tech and Facebook at facebook.com/blendertechpage, all one word. If you disliked this video for some reason, however, please leave us a comment to tell us why. And if it's private, just email us at info@blendertech.com. That way we can continually improve our videos based on community input. And that's what our main goal is to constantly be improving our videos based on what you tell us. And we also take requests and call for help, so if you're having an issue with something or you want to see a tutorial or something of the like, please let us know. So see you next time, and remember, create your way.